Gillibrand, more like Gillibrando, given that it's what plants crave.
Gilla, nah, I don't got it. Nah, I don't got it. I don't got it.
Gilla, bet she ain't never gonna be president, bitch.
Yeah, she's definitely not gonna be fucking president. What's going on, everybody? Welcome to Hump Day, Saints, Midweek Saints. Kristen Gillibrand just dropped out of the presidential race, and we couldn't be happier. So,
I'm very happy. I'm exceptionally happy.
I will cheers.
A vapid basic bitch Becky gynocentrist is no longer trying to pretend that she has any business in government. Cheers.
I cheers you with my carton.
Sorry, I guess I'm just channeling that quartering energy right now. I'm getting all up in arms about a non-issue. Gillibrand's out, which means there's only 49 remaining Democratic candidates for the nomination. So,
we're making progress. Progress.
I was actually, I loved it. I think it was last week. Biden was here in New Hampshire, and he was out in Keene, where I used to live, no less.
Okay.
And they said, what's your impression of Keene? And he says, how can you not love Keene? I love Vermont. Who doesn't love Vermont?
Ooh. Ooh.
Yeah. Now, in fairness,
Keene is in New Hampshire.
It is, but in fairness, Keene is very, very much, it's a very Vermont town. Here's the weird thing. Here in New England, right? So you take, you've got Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont, Massachusetts.
Right, right.
The western tier of Massachusetts going up through Vermont, and then the slice of the western part of New Hampshire.
Uh-huh.
That was a hippie settlement after the whole Grateful Dead free love movement broke up and fell apart and fizzled off. A lot of them moved up here to sort of settle, hoping they could find a place where they could just smoke their dope in the woods, man, and, like, you know, own 22s and grow their hair and beards out.
Sure.
The weird thing that resulted from this is there's three cities. There's Brattleboro, Vermont, Keene, New Hampshire, and Northampton, Massachusetts. If you go through any of these towns and then follow it up with a visit to any of the other towns, you will notice they are the same town. The same.
Are they close to each other?
Well, I mean, they're each, I mean, well, like, Brattleboro is about an hour away from Keene, give or take, maybe 45 minutes an hour.
Okay.
Northampton is about an hour and a half, I'd say, from both of them. But when I say they're the same town, I mean, like, it's the same independent record store. It's the same secondhand hippie thrift shops. It's the same. And when I say the same, they're not just similar. They are the same stores. They're
That's
like franchises.
Really weird. That's yeah. really, really weird.
And they're all clinging onto the edges of liberal arts colleges. And it's really strange because when I live in Keene, I remember the first time I went and saw an Amanda Palmer play in Northampton, Mass. That was actually where I got to be met and became friends with Elias Kahn of Nervous Cabaret. And as I was just meandering around Northampton, I'm like, this is exactly like Keene. What the fuck is going on? Same thing in Brattleboro. So I can't fault Joe Biden and his octogenarian brain for
I can.
Me. Oh, I mean, I will.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. How old is Biden at this point? Hang on. I want to find out. I gotta know. How old is Uncle... Oh, Joe Biden. I really like calling him Uncle Joe. He's almost an octogenarian. He's 76 years old.
Well, I mean, that makes him almost an octogenarian in the same way that I'm almost 40.
Yeah.
So, wait a second. Uncle Joe, not referring to Stalin... Everyone knows that's Bernie. Was 30 when I was born.
Yeah.
He would have been going through his first child support fight.
Bernie is only 1 year older than Joe Biden. That's good to know.
Well, you see, I mean, you look at the two of them, you can see the age on Bernie a lot better than Joe, but you can hear it a lot more in Joe's voice. And that's what happens when you spend more time trying to govern than you try... Then you spend trying to climb a ladder to become the highest, most important senator from MasterCard that ever existed.
This is our 100th episode of Midweek Saints. That's kind of cool.
And actually, Hang on, let me see what the size of the fucking thing is here. Yeah, you know what? Fuck it. We'll just do it throughout. Let's throw that big thing I've got going on in celebration of this 100th episode. And in my very desperate attempt to find some meaningful egress from the world of YouTube, you can now actually order my book.
Mm-hmm. It's at clashbooks.com, written by Nicholas Gouroff, Laughter of a Scoundrel, signed and personalized, limited to 300 copies.
Yeah, we got 300. I haven't signed them yet, but I will.
That is a really nice cover.
I like it.
That's way better than my cover. Holy shit, dude.
That's what you get when you work with Clash Books. That's why I'm telling you, you should actually talk to Christoph.
Yeah, well.
About republication. Yeah, well. But yeah, that's the third iteration of the cover. That was the one I agreed to. And that blurb there is half of the blurb which will appear on the back cover. The foreword is written by none other than Vernaculus himself. And yeah, so I'm now an author. And that is my book, and you can buy it. And Jeff, can you drop the link to them in the chat there?
Sure.
Yeah, so you can go and buy my book now. I'm sure like there's about 7 of you who will really enjoy it.
Yeah, I mean, shit, man, that's cool. I'll have to fucking grab one too.
That's a nice way I feel to ring in the whole 100th episode business is, hey guys, help me escape the downward spiral of YouTube.
Yeah, it is a downward spiral. Oh my god, man.
It would be, I uploaded 2 videos this week and I think I've lost about 40. I'm actually only 20 subscribers away from falling below 20,000 again, so.
I believe in you, we can do this. Here, let me unsubscribe with mine too. Mm. That's a joke, I'm not gonna do that, of course not. I did that a long time ago. Nah, I'm kidding about that too.
Well, I mean, if notifications are any, inference. I do love, though, one of the things I'm really hoping to do in writing books is that when you write a book, you can express a whole point and there's no fucking comment section for some jackass to say, hey, I listened to half of what you said, and listen, I don't appreciate you talking bad about me like that. Huh?
Who? What?
Sorry, what? I'm sorry, Jethro. I don't think we've been formally acquainted.
Some random person thought that one of your videos is about him?
Not specifically. It was just funny because I did a video recently where I was pointing out like the slow mission creep of oligarchy and tyranny.
Yeah.
Big brain concepts. If you guys watch The Quartering, you probably won't like it. But yeah, and I tried pointing out how, you know, generations past, like a pipe fitter or an electrician could comfortably, very comfortably, maintain a single income household of 5, sending the kids to college.
Oh, sure.
Whereas these days, my own brother, who's an electrician, lives in a dual income household with no children.
Hmm.
Still just gets by. But we're all told, oh, no, this is the way it's always been. It's always been hard. It's always been a struggle. It's a struggle now. It's as hard as it's ever been.
Sure.
And I'm like, no, it hasn't, because wages have been relatively stagnant and buying power has actually gone down for the average consumer.
Right.
And the response to this is like, clearly you don't know nothing about roofing. You can make 6 figures doing that.
I mean, you can.
Furthermore, low 6 figures still, it's like low 6 figures with housing prices, cost of college, cost of living,
right,
family
right.
of 5.
Right.
You're still getting by.
You're still just, well, I mean, like, if you manage to get low 6 figures, I think you could probably do okay in, like, maybe getting into middle class suburb in a town that's not especially that expensive. But like a major metropolitan area, no way.
Yeah, Crispy Gin, listen, real quick, buddy. It's not a bitter point. It's the fact that there are a whole load of really stupid fucking people pushing a whole load of really stupid fucking shit on a very ADD-addled online social media market who will lap up stupid shit because it gives them the outrage of the fucking week. But hey, we're not like those SJWs, guys. We're nothing like them.
Nah, not at all. Here's the thing that you got to keep in mind, because this does come up every now and then. I actually do like Jeremy Hambly. I do. He helped me co-host this show once. He and I have always gone along just fine. The thing is, if you ask him dead to his face, hey man, how much do you really, like, care about any of this shit? He's gonna tell you, I don't. I don't give a fuck. I don't fucking care about any of this shit. It's all about the fucking money. He will tell you, to your face, that's what it's all about. Because he said it in public many times. That type of video making, he's very honest that he does not give that much of a shit. Neither does people like Tim Pool. Tim Pool openly was stating to people that he was going to work the algorithm with the way he was going to do Timcast. This is no big secret. This is just the way it is. Now, calling it like limp dick lazy fucking clickbaity content is not an insult. It's just the truth. And it's not even really being mean to them. It's just being like, hey, it's effective. Because it is. And yeah. They found and the grift and let them do their grift. Fuck it, whatever. Who cares?
Yeah, and ultimately, like, the, you know, the bitter point, if there is one, is that this is what motherfuckers apparently give a shit about.
Yeah, that's
everything
that's
else
what's
on this
weird.
Fucking planet can be burning. It's that dog sitting in the burning fucking room saying, this is fine. Everything can be completely fucked, and people will genuinely give a fuck if some nerd critic YouTuber at one point was some kind of pervy sex pest right. in some way. Or the fact that the Thundercats reboot looks more like Adventure Time than it does the original G.I. Joe. These are the kind of, I mean, like, if nobody who actually follows this shit and gives the slightest remote inklings of fucks about it is allowed to ever ask or even ponder, how did the world get so fucked up?
I think that's probably the thing that's most important, though, to take away when it comes to that kind of criticism as well, is like, because you made a very salient point. Like, if people didn't actually care about this obnoxious, stupid shit, nobody would watch those videos, but they do, and so they fill the market for that. Fuck it, whatever, dude. That's fine.
Yeah, no, I mean, we're all gonna be dead in, you know, 20 to 60 years anyway, so.
So somebody was asking what I was drinking. This is 1 liter of Pinot Grigio in a cardboard box.
I was so hoping you were gonna say it's a liter of cola.
A liter of cola. It's 1 liter of alcoholic cola. Fermented grape juice.
I still mourn that franchise with that sequel.
I couldn't get past the opening scene.
It was so bad.
Super Troopers 2. I couldn't get past the opening scene. People told me that it gets better, but I can't.
No, it didn't.
It didn't.
Mm. No, it was like really lazy rehashings of the old jokes that they had from the first one, which worked, reminding you that those worked the first time.
Yeah.
And then it was like, no. No, man.
No. No, to be honest with you, I didn't really ever like any Broken Lizard movies except for Super Troopers, and then Beer Fest I kind of grew to like. Sort
of. Beer Fest is fun if you're really high.
I don't do weed bongs, man. So, you know.
Yeah. I mean, well, it's like Super Troopers is fun on its own, and it's really fun if you're high.
Yeah.
Beer Fest, actually, you can't, I don't know. I can't even say that Beer Fest is fun drunk, because I can't. Well, drunk never makes any movies better.
What was the other Broken Lizard one? Was it Club Dread?
It was Club Dread, and then there was one more.
That shit was awful. That was a really bad movie. Club Dread was a really, really, really bad. You cannot take Farva and make him into, like, the hunky man in the next movie. You can't do that. You can't. Yeah. We've seen his penis.
Yeah, no.
It was ambitious. It just didn't work. I get what they were trying to do. It just didn't work.
Although, I mean, I have heard that Lemmy and Jay Lemmy, because he and the, I forget his name in Super Troopers too, the guy with the mustache, they have like a stage show It's one of those like improvish comedy slash skit slash fuck with the audience kind of nights that they do.
Sure. And, sure.
Yeah. I mean, like, that's been remarkably well reviewed because those, all of those guys are themselves fucking hilariously funny.
Oh no, I don't doubt it. The guy, I really am not gonna try and pronounce his fucking name.
J.H. Handerscar.
Yes, that guy.
Yeah.
He is fucking hilarious. Holy shit. That skit that they did, that prank that they did in the Jackass movie.
Yeah, when he was the
he was a cab driver.
Yeah.
And he like legit got into it and started punching one of the members of Jackass right in the face.
Yeah.
That was great. That was pretty amazing.
Yeah, so. No, all of those guys, I mean Super Troopers as a film was fucking hilarious. I loved it. Especially like the first time you watch it, you're sitting there like, how the fuck is this a real movie? This is great. And then, yeah, and it, you know, I think it was Larry who said it's trying to capture lightning in a bottle. It's like that's the danger if you're trying to like do a follow up or a sequel like that.
Yeah, yeah. It's there's something about, was it Larry that said the lightning in the bottle fucking quote? Shit. No, I can't find it, motherfucker.
Somebody said it.
Jables said it was.
Oh, Jables.
Yeah, it's kind of like one of those, do you really need a sequel? Really? It's perfect on its own. Just leave it alone. But obviously, all the rest of their attempts were not quite working out.
Are you picking up any of this audio?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Here, let's listen to it for a second. Wow.
Yeah, if you're one of the 3.5 people out there who regularly wonders why I don't put more videos out, I sit down to record. You can believe that. I just happen to have a Tanzanian village living upstairs.
Mm. Yeah.
Now, in truth, though, I fucking love those kids.
Sure.
Yeah, there's like 7 of them. Like, 3 of them are cousins to 4 of them who live up there, so they all run up and down and hang out here. But if I leave the house, if I like leave the house to even just go to the shop next door, and they catch me on like the lower landing, they will line up with their hands up like this, and they are demanding high fives.
Okay.
And you have to high five each of them, and then once you get through like the 4 or 5 high fives you give, the first one you give a high five to will put a fist up because they want you to bump it.
Right.
And then you go through that, and then like the older ones will piss off, and then like the really little ones will stand there thinking like, we're just gonna do this all day.
That's pretty adorable. Like, that's yeah, that's pretty cute.
Yeah, you can make it through like maybe 3 or 4 rounds of it before you're like, wait, hang on, and then they're all just demanding it once. You're like, wait, hang. Okay, no, I got you. No, wait, there we go. Bah, 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 and you start punching them, and then all of a sudden police show up, and it's, you know, it everything starts with the best of intentions.
Of course. Your apartment always reminds me of Adriana Game Over. You remember her from way back in the day? She lives in Spain, and she's a painter and a comic creator. She's really cool. She's also really fucking hot. But she lives in an apartment complex in Spain, which is basically like, you know, all the worst neighborhoods in like the movie Snatch or Lock, Stock, and Two Smoking Barrels, like the real shitty, you know, apartment complexes and those types of movies. Yeah, she lives in one of those.
Well, you know, it's funny to me. I've recently just finished watching Rome, HBO's Rome.
Oh, I love that show.
Yeah. And, well, it's funny, though, because, like, lately when, like, there's just kids running around and people screaming at each other and all that shit here, like, I just keep wishing there was more, like, bones and weird shit hanging from the back stairwell. Because I'm just like, all I need is a clay jug of wine and to be wearing much more aerated clothing. And, yeah, it hasn't changed much. Honestly, it hasn't. I mean, You know, the poor live amongst the poor with the children running around and they're all fine and you high-five them and they're playing with broken toys. And
sure.
And then we're all ruled by a fistful of inbred, unfeeling oligarchs who are praised by the masses because they don't know any better.
Yeah, that's fair. I get it. I get it.
The empire never ended, y'all. It just moved west.
That's right. Okay, so catching up, bunch of little bitties. Yami Jackie says, hi, boys. Hope you're doing good today. Not bad. Cube Book, thank you very much for the resubscription. 8 months so far. Appreciate you. Yami Jackie, it seems like St. Paul, Minneapolis situation. People always think the capital for our state is both, but it's only St. Paul, despite how close they are together. I've only driven through St. Paul, Minneapolis once. But I remember driving through Minneapolis, and I was like, meh. And then we drove through St. Paul, and I saw, I think it's the Capitol building or something. It's a very old, big, gorgeous building. And, like, that's the thing that I always remember is that big, fuck-off, gorgeous old building. Maybe you can type it in the chat if you remember what building that is.
I had some fun in those cities, too. In fact, in Minneapolis, there's a tiki bar.
Okay.
Yeah. Friend of mine who lived there when I went out there to work invited me out. She's like, hey, it's a girls' night, but I convinced them you could come along. I'm like, okay, I'll go hang out with a bunch of Scandinavian women.
Sure.
And, well, here's the weird thing. You've met me. I'm like 5-6-ish feet tall, let's say.
Sure.
I'm used to being like middle to higher, like height in a given room. You walk into a bar in Minneapolis and you're surrounded by Scandinavians who are like 9-12 feet tall, something like that. Yeah, I'm bellying up to the bar and I'm just like, when did I become a hobbit? That is also where I learned about what I have come to call Minnesota sushi, however. You take a piece or two of deli ham.
Right.
Spread cream cheese on it, put a pickle spear in it, roll it up, and eat it.
That sounds really good. You know
it
what
really is.
You know what drives me crazy? For some fucking reason, I tend to attract tall men. Like, I'm always friends with very tall men. All the time. All my best friends are very tall. Tall men.
That's by nature of the fact that Aragorn recognizes the virtue of the halflings.
Well, shut the fuck up. Oh my god. Because I'm very average height, you know, but for some reason I always get along with very, very tall men. So anytime I'm out in public, I always look like the fucking short guy. It's really weird. Well, I mean, I don't really give that much of a shit either. I'm not out there trying to scam on some bitches, but
it's not like when you're at a bagel shop, you feel the need to start.
No, definitely not. But you know what? I do make all my friends look a lot taller if they're already tall. So maybe that's why they hang out with me?
On that note, though, I am so happy that the bagel boss guy has a Twitter now because, like, I don't think that. I mean, I'm discovering there, like, my bag of Lollipop Kid jokes is much, much deeper than I thought.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. No, for sure. I'm always cheating wearing my boots every time I see it. I wear boots every day. What the fuck? Oh, my God. You better watch yourself, Jables. I will drink you under the table in 2 days. 2 days. I'll annihilate your vagina. It's going to be fun.
Indeed.
Go to PAX. Is anybody... Well, I know we have some Seattle family in the Saints community. I'll be up there going to PAX on Friday and Saturday until about Sunday mid-afternoon is when I'll be heading home. So maybe we'll do a thing. I'll announce it here in probably tomorrow, whenever we decide what we're doing. Larry Kubiak says, don't know how I feel about this new Joker. Do you have the mic circle open? I guess that answer is no.
Oh, no, I had it open. I just didn't have it on the right screen. There we go.
All right.
Hi, this is Tommy Wiseau, creator of The Room. Let me introduce you to the new Joker.
Ah!
You know, it's the villain that Batfleck deserves.
Oh my fucking god, dude. That fucking perfectly timed scream is amazing. Holy shit. Let's watch that again, and then I think I want to watch actually the whole thing.
Hi, yeah. This is Tommy Wiseau, creator of The Room. Let me introduce you to the new Joker.
Hi, Bruce.
I know the Nerdist. Should we watch the Joker audition tape or the Dark Knight scenes with Tommy Wiseau?
Ooh, I think the audition tape sounds more fun.
Okay, all right.
Him auditioning sounds like more fun than him trying to recreate scenes.
The scene recreation wasn't bad.
Oh, I don't doubt either are bad. I'm just thinking, like...
You know, I really wish... Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, like, him auditioning, because he is a true actor from the New Orleans, the Big Easy. And you know that he really will go for it.
I want to see... What did you guys just fucking post in the chat? What the fuck is this? Oh, my... That's not what my boots... Oh, my fucking God. You guys are trying to claim I'm, like, a short person or something. It's really weird. I don't understand why people are so obsessed with height. It's bizarre, dude. Anyway, here you go.
This is the bagel guy.
Hi, this is Tommy Wiseau, creator of The Room. Let me introduce you to the new Joker. Ah! Ah!
I wish this was the Santa Cruz Joker. I want to see the Santa Cruz Joker's audition tape. Do you follow him?
No.
No?
I tried, and then after a while, I just was like, I couldn't. No shade or hate or anything. It was just one of these, like, I don't... I mean, especially because I also follow Olive, and that is like one of the strangest romances.
Oh, Coherent States. The history of the internet. The Santa Cruz Joker. Yeah, man. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It's
great shit.
I don't have the RAM for it, you know?
Yeah.
Doesn't kill you, make you stranger. Oh! Joker. It's simple. We kill the Batman. Have you ever...
It's a Polish accent, right? A really heavy Polish accent.
He's clearly a New Orleans accent.
No, it is...
Very much Big Easier all the way, baby.
I come from New York.
Ever dance with a devil in the pale moonlight? Did you? No, but I did. I did like a devil. I'm not the monster. No, I'm just ahead of the curve. He has come to me. Come on.
Okay. No, okay, more.
Not the monster. No. Why? So serious? Why so serious? Why so serious? Let's put a smile on this face. Why?
Oh, why so serious?
One more.
So serious! Jingle bell, Batman smell.
Action.
Bang.
I like how they let him wear his trademark pants.
I like how he just dyed his own hair.
Yeah, that's pretty good too. Yeah. All right. Anyway. Fuck me. Holy shit. That's ridiculous. How do you feel about this Joaquin Phoenix Joker thing?
Well, I mean, when I first heard that Heath Ledger was going to play him, my reaction was, huh?
Yeah. Didn't make sense.
But Joaquin Phoenix is a fucking amazing actor.
Yep.
And I have a weird feeling. I have a feeling people are really going to... I think they're going to come to love the movie. I think it's going to be one of these things where, like, they really remember it, but it's not going to be what a lot of people expect.
That's kind of what I'm curious about. Yes, yeah, I mean St. Paul's Cathedral. That's right.
Yeah.
That's what I saw when I was in St. Paul. That's cool.
Big yeah, it's weird there. When you show up to it on a fucking really rainy, shitty day, and you're just like, wow, it's big.
Yeah. No, it was just a hell of a thing to randomly see when we were like driving through, and I'm like, that is wow, crazy. Reminds me of what's the one that almost spurred down? Notre Dame? Kind of reminds me of Notre Dame.
I thought you said almost spurred out. I'm like, no, they all spurred out.
Well, okay, so the thing is, I don't know what the Joker movie is supposed to be. And I think that's the thing that's both repelling me from it and making me still very interested. There are people who've already made up their minds, like, oh, it's going to be fucking brilliant, or oh, it's got to be terrible. Like, you don't even know what any of it has to do with anything. Like, they've actually done a trailer that is the exact opposite of what they always do trailers. Most of the time, trailers will just show you the whole fucking movie, and then, yeah, you might get a couple of thrills here and there, but for the most part, you understand what it is. This one, I have no idea what the fuck this movie's about. No fucking clue.
Yeah, I mean, at a guess, just from what I've seen of it, and what we've seen released from its production, it looks very much like it's going to basically... It's not supposed to necessarily be a Joker origin story as much as... Well, not the Joker origin story as much as a Joker origin story. The story of somebody who just breaks and becomes a psychopathic criminal.
Sure.
Of some kind. Because here's the other thing, too. Keep in mind, the name of this iteration is Arthur Fleck, right?
Right.
And what I forget where I picked this up from. It was one of the nerd channels that
Affleck,
I watched. That,
yeah, yeah. Affleck. Yeah. Affleck, yeah.
Yeah. And with that, though, I mean, so, like, we're not getting Jared Leto's, like, oh, I'm so into this. Ah. You know, we're getting a Joaquin Phoenix style guy trying his best to keep it together, can't quite do it, breaks and becomes something else.
You know what's really weird? Okay, unpopular opinion. I think with a director that was actually competent, Leto's Joker probably could have been pretty good. I liked the idea of it. I really did. The idea of having a Joker that is first and foremost a criminal. Like, he's a criminal mastermind. He's basically like Scarface meets comic book Joker. Meets like dirty, 2010 tweens? Whatever the fuck it's called. Whatever this time period is. 20 teens, body mod thing. Like, I think it could have been fine. You know,
Leto's Joker, all of the scenes were with Jared Leto's Joker were the best parts of Suicide Squad.
Yeah, hands down. I didn't even like Harley Quinn in that movie. I didn't think she was very good. I thought she kind of sucked.
Nobody was good in that.
But I think his Joker was actually not that bad. Not that bad.
No. Whenever, like, the first watch through I had of it, every time it was a scene with him in it, I'm like, oh, thank God. An entertaining part of the movie, because otherwise it was basically like just watching your average fans only thought roam around like, oh my god, piss off with that, please.
Sure.
And give these characters more to do. Also, I mean, then there's also the whole notion of the Suicide Squad concept itself as it was presented there was fucking stupid. Nobody in the movie seemed like they were remotely happy to be there.
No, everybody looked really pissed off.
Everybody looked really upset. It was like, I imagine they probably signed up all eager, like, yeah, I'm going to get in on this comic book movie craze. And then they read the script and they're like, wait, I signed the contract before I read this?
The girl that played Enchantress is so pretty, though. Very pretty.
Yeah, but I mean, yeah, I mean, the whole thing sucked. And then, like, Jared Leto showed up and was entertaining,
and the only decent part of it, that people don't like to admit it, but Jared Leto is actually a really good fucking actor.
He is. here's a funny thing too. If you look, I mean, if you even go to YouTube, right, and you look up the clips, the most viewed clips are his scenes.
Oh, sure.
Or the music, or the fanboy, fangirl music videos made with his scenes. In fact, I think actually what that song "I Need a Gangsta."
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like at one point, I recall seeing the sort of fan edit music video made from the clips of the movie was more viewed than the actual thought provoking. Music video itself.
Right. Yeah. No, I feel you. I don't know, man. It's weird. It's very unfortunate. I loved the tattoo. The tattoo really made me happy. Like the whole like damage thing at the top, but the fucking hand tattoo thing.
Well, you knew,
I actually
you know,
really loved that, and if that movie was good, I probably would have gotten a tattoo very similar to that. But the movie's so bad that now I can never do it, even though it's a great idea. Like,
well, that's, I mean, one of the biggest fuck-ups that DC has done is, because, like, Marvel did a decent job of dropping their Easter eggs and laying the ground game for future things in the movies.
Sure.
DC tried that because the theory I'd heard was that that tattoo plus the whole grill thing.
Yeah.
Was connected to when you see that scene, I think it was in Batman vs. Superman, where Batman looks like mournfully at the Robin costume tagged up with Joker tags.
Mm-hmm.
Because in canon, Joker murders Robin brutally.
Yeah, yeah, Jason Todd. He murders Jason Todd.
Yeah, and the idea there was that rather than kill him, Batman beat all of Joker's teeth out of his fucking mouth. So he got that smile.
Right, and then eventually got the grill. Yeah.
Yeah. That and the thing was is like that was all it was like it's almost like they thought their audience was more into the canon than they would be.
Sure.
Because Marvel understands they're like, all right, we're gonna bring the comic nerds in, but what we really need are the kind of people who will cheer for like Star Wars reboots.
G Money says that hand tattoo is like the retarded mustache finger tattoos that hipsters got 5 years ago. My wife has that tattoo.
Yeah, how do you feel now, G-Money, huh?
So anyway, we're not really going to watch it, but Anime Moon's like, I'm poor because of things for my family, but here's a terrible link. And I'm like, okay, fine. You know what? We'll look at it just to make fun of how bad it is. It's okay. Yeah, that was awful. Jesus Christ, you should feel bad, man. Yep. Yeah, that's it. Nope. Nope. Nope.
All right, well, we do have fun news.
We do. Let's do that. Let's do that. Fuck it. All right, first and foremost, odd news. Florida vacation home invaded by vomiting vultures.
Oh, no!
What the fuck? a New York couple's luxurious vacation house in Florida has been taken over by dozens of black vultures that are vomiting and defecating everywhere. The Palm Beach Post reports that the Casimano family can't even visit the $702,000 home they purchased earlier this year in the Ibis Golf and Country Club. I know. Those poor people.
As somebody who struggles to pay his rent, I really feel for them.
Oh, man. That's so sad. That's terrible.
You know, I'm going to take a Ben Shapiro on this. Listen, if you didn't want giant vultures vomiting and shitting all over your vacation property, you should have just sold that vacation property and bought another one somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Absolutely. Siobhan Casimano described the smell as like 1,000 rotting corpses. The vultures have destroyed screen enclosures and have overtaken the pool and barbecue. The few times the family has visited, they've had to park their car in the garage to avoid the birds pecking at them with their beaks. A neighbor, Cheryl Katz, told the... Where is this? West Palm Beach? Okay. Neighbor Cheryl Katz told the Post she's got it even worse because she lives next door to a person who is feeding the vultures and other wildlife. And,
I love it, whoever that is.
Yeah, whoever that is a fucking baller,
fucking
dude.
Fucking hero.
In May, she said vultures tore through her pool enclosure and couldn't figure out how to get out. Imagine 20 vultures trapped, biting each other, and they can bite through bone, she said. They would bang against my windows, running away from a bird that was attacking them. Blood was everywhere. It was a vile, vicious, traumatic event, and it was Memorial Day, so no company I called would come out to help me. Finally, three police officers arrived. They removed the screens and shooed away the vultures. Since she has chronic lymphocytic leukemia, which leaves her vulnerable to infections, she's had to be extra careful going outside, even having someone power wash the patio twice.
Wow. Oh, somebody's got some shitty neighbors.
The homeowners blame Katz's as neighbor, a woman who they claim is excessively feeding wildlife. Katz said she had seen the neighbor give bags of dog food and even a roasted chicken to the vultures. Jesus Christ. Neighborhood Association President Gordon Holness said association members have warned the woman, but are limited in what they could do because the vultures are migratory birds protected by federal law.
Oh, don't worry. Trump will take care of that. But,
oh, yeah.
I want to find this neighbor and just recommend, be like, listen, you should become a big donor to the ASPCA. And then just go and find those animals that are on their last legs so you can offer them as animal sacrifices to the vulture gods who keep your neighbors horribly pissed off.
Okay. Peoples have suggested scaring the vultures off with fireworks or balloons. Katz said the newspaper quoted an expert as saying that killing a vulture, having it stuffed and hanging it in a prominent place would work because vultures avoid their own dead. This is we. But Kat said she found out from the U.S. Wildlife Service that it is hard to get a federal permit to kill the protected bird. Kat said she even tried putting out four fake owls that have moving heads and blinking lights. The vultures chewed the owls apart, she said. They ripped the heads off.
I put out what looked like stationary mammals, and they killed them.
Oh, man. That's great.
Wow. I, for one, welcome our new vulture overlords.
Yeah, me too.
Also, fuck West Palm Beach, Florida in general.
Fuck Florida, man. I mean...
Yeah, honestly, I'm really... You know what they need to do is they need to deploy Florida men to take care of these birds.
Just get them all hopped up on fucking meth, give them each a machete, and let them... do what comes naturally.
Or just contact Gail Cord Schuler. I'm sure she can psychically tell the birds to go after Jesuits in other neighborhoods, unless these people are Jesuits.
That might be why they haven't called yet.
Yeah, don't feel too bad about these people until whether or not you find out what side of the Great Coming War they're really on.
Although, to be fair, I don't think Gail is very well versed in bird law.
She has men for that.
That's true. She does have men for that.
Are you still a patron of hers, by the way?
Mm-hmm. I haven't watched one of her videos in forever, though. We can watch one.
That's like most of my patrons. Let's watch one.
All right. Let me see. What do we got here? I'll read out some of these.
Swear to Christ, I'm like waiting for an exit survey. Be like, yeah, I've been a patron for 2 years. I just thought you had cancer or something.
Let's see. 4 days ago, nudity to be glorious in Christ's 1,000-year reign.
That sounds perfect.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely. See, this is what you gotta do, Anime Moon. Don't post these stupid fucking anime videos to me anymore. Post Gail Cord Schuler links, and then everybody will like you. And everybody likes you anyway. You're a really nice guy. I love you. I just really hate your taste in anime. A lot.
You see that red spot there? That's from the bombs that Lori or Melania Trump, Lori McBride or Melania Trump are dropping over my head.
Hang on. You haven't watched it in a while. I think there's going to need to be some catching up done because Lori McBride and Melania Trump are, if not the same person, in cahoots?
Yeah, I think so. I didn't know that Melania... Man, I got to message Zach Knight. He and I have been meaning to, like, hang out and get together for a long-ass time. We talk every now and then. But, I'm not caught up on the lore. I guess Melania Trump is now in league with Lori McBride. Because Angelina Ballerina's dead. Did you know that?
No, it didn't.
Yeah, Zack Knight did a sensual dance, and he hypnotized her, and she came over, and she put her mouth on his penis, and he ejaculated so hard that he blew the back of her head off.
We all been there.
Oh, no, for sure, yeah. But now, it's Lori McBride, and it's apparently Melania Trump, too, so here we go.
That felt like acid yesterday. Apparently she's I am allergic to yeast toxins, so if all these yeast germs, if I'm inhaling the yeast, and then they're trying to escape from my body because of the Seroquel.
Can I say, though, that between the Seroquel and all of Zack Knight's semen, her skin is looking radiant here.
She looks good. She looks really good. I've been a little worried for her, but she looks really healthy right now. but yeah, apparently, and it was an old tactic of Angelina Ballerina, but apparently now, Melania and, Lori McBride are dropping yeast bombs on Gail, so.
Coming out, that was burning last night, boy. I took a little extra Seroquel, and I'm starting to drink out of my cup that gets Zack Knight's semen, because it's like a super potent.
Hang on a second. Hang on. I got somebody at the door. Hang on.
No. I thought he was just amazed at how astutely I said that it was either the Seroquel or Zack Knight's semen, which was giving her this radiant glow. But I mean, goodness gracious, Gail, like, your pores look like they're each pregnant. You got to admit, in this freeze frame, she looks a bit like a Skyrim NPC, which I think she should be. If anybody is doing Skyrim modding, I expect to see every citizen of every city becoming Milady Gale.
Sorry, I had to give a big hug to a very nice smelling, gorgeous redhead chick who just showed up. Anyway, she's pretty. All right, so we missed just a bit here. Let's get this.
Drink out of my cup that gets Zack Knight's semen because it's like a super potent antibiotic. But that's not the reason I'm making this video, but I just wanted to show you what those bombs that she's dropping over my head, what they're doing to me. I'm getting yeast spots on my skin. I wanted to talk about the subject of nudity and sexuality from Jesus Christ's perspective.
Okay.
Because I've noticed that either Melania Trump or Lori McBride are trying to shame me by allowing some of my nudes, my Playboy nudes, to surface. Actually, this has been going on for years, so I think it's become.
Did you forget about that? She did pose for, she posed for Playboy.
Oh, I'm sure. I'm absolutely certain of it.
I'm not high enough tier of a patron to get her nudes, unfortunately. It's I mean, you know. Let's give Gail
fans only kind of shit, right?
That's right. So far, Gail has not started a Manycams account, or OnlyFans, or do premium Snap, but it's really only a matter of time until somebody is patient enough to explain it to her.
I mean, more mainstream. And I just wanted to let you know that it was actually Jesus Christ himself who convinced me that it was okay to pose for Playboy. Jesus Christ showed up to explain to us explain what happened to Hugh Hefner when he died. Actually, Hugh Hefner was going to give me and Brent his Playboy mansion.
Mm-hmm.
And Lori McBride, when she found out, she was fuming, jealous, and that's why she killed him. She hired an obese black woman named Urethra Bosizzle. I think that was her name.
Yeah, no. I mean, seems legit. I'm sure she's got all the court records to prove that the urethra killed Hugh Hefner.
I'm gonna throw up, I swear to God.
Honestly, I haven't had my mind this blown since I found out 9/11 was an inside job.
Oh, fuck. Oh, my God.
Name. and urethra apparently Hugh Hefner liked to have black women some erotic asphyxiation thing he liked to do where he would almost, you know, quit breathing, and then that's how he would get an erection and all this stuff. I'm not into this, but apparently he was into it. It's cool with Jesus.
That would be
Jesus
weird,
Dale.
Jesus
doesn't have a problem with it. In fact, Hugh Hefner died for two reasons. He died of autoerotic asphyxiation because the black woman got on top of him and she wouldn't get up, and so she suffocated him. He also had an explosion, I think it was in his testicles because of a blood clot, and he lost a lot of blood. So he died for two reasons. So Jesus said it was technically a murder, and also he died from the blood clot explosion.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for clarifying. I thought it was a medical condition. I didn't know that it was a giant black urethra that killed him.
Oh God! Oh,
the more
God.
You know.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. You know what? You know, I'm surprised though that she hasn't actually caught on to the fact that Larry Flint was behind all of this.
It's true. Most people did not know that.
No.
All right.
My men informed me.
Your men informed you?
I have many of them. They live in the clouds.
I have many men. They are top men.
They are taut.
Okay.
Sinewy.
All right, so...
Vascular.
Led Zepp boy, very much. Thank you very much for resubscribing. 6 months so far. Goddamn, I'm getting, like, dyslexia, but with my speech. What's that called? Brain damage? Okay. All right, good.
Yeah.
This is from Larry. Larry
says,
old meme.
Ninth grade education.
Old meme, novel execution.
How much Alex Gray is incorporated in this shit?
It made me stroke out.
A little bit. I think I lost enough brain function to, move to Iowa and vote for Steve King.
If you guys want to hop into the waiting room here in just a little bit, we are going to roll.
No.
And we're going to grab people and pull them in.
We at least need to play the Scotsman.
Oh, no, I know. I was thinking we're definitely going to do that before... wait, which one is the Scotsman? Fuck, hang on.
Well, there's the story and then
there's the
video.
Yeah, no, I want to do that before we... get into it. Okay, you get to read this one though. But yeah, get in the waiting room in the Discord.
Oh yes, there we go. Yeah. So Scotsman gets into hilarious argument with Alexa as device ignores his requests. Amazon Alexa is quite a racist cunt according to many Scottish hounds. But after a few drinks, the voice-activated wonder can still struggle to get your cock in her mouth. The hilarious video, filmed by Tracy McGuinness, shows her mum's fiancé, Billy, 64, struggling to get an Alexa to play John Lennon music. Instead, Alexa insists on playing the Bee Gees hit, How Deep Is Your Love?
Should we just play it?
Oh, we play it now, yeah.
Oh, aye.
The volume up with John Lennon, please, if you don't mind.
Do you know listening to you?
You're listening to one of us. Why don't you stay in the f***ing and listen to me? Must be talking to you. Alexa, can you do me a favour, please? Thomas, to John Lennon, please, if you don't mind. Christ almighty, you got these f***ing morons on. Alexa, could you turn John Lennon on, please? You got the f***ing Bee Gees, John, I don't like them. Excuse me, darling. Listen.
Listen.
We're paying for this shit. John Lennon.
This is Scottish public service. Jeff Holliday here.
Listen. God almighty. Where are you? Planet, you're there. John Lennon on.
You shouldn't listen to you, Billy.
Bet John Lennon on.
Alexa?
You're just paying me. You cheeky
That's some good shit.
Racist against drunken Scots, which makes it racist against pretty much all the Scots at this point.
That's right. That's absolutely right.
Rotten fucking technology, Jeff Bezos, you racist cunt. Don't you know that fucking... Why you fucking Wallace fought for the right for John Lennon to be played in my nightstand, you cunt, you?
Alright. Larry says, speaking of Scotsmen, footage of Dankula, a visit in New York... Done with shitpost now. Okay.
Hocus pocus, there's pizza on your focus.
What the fuck? It's not actually Dankula, but that would be good.
Hocus pocus, there's pizza on your focus.
Pizza on your focus. You know, when you speak a language that isn't your native tongue and you do it with an accent that you made up in the 1950s, you can make as many rhymes as you like.
Yeah.
What is it? Well, I mean, Scottish Twitter is one of my favorite things. I saw one which was like, I was going through the Wendy's drive-thru then, and I ordered a large lemonade, and they say, would you like a fucking... What was it? Would you like a cup holder? And nah, I'm a fucking octopus, you fucking genius, you. Or you, was it you, scholar?
I have no idea what you're saying, but I do know that you need to get into the waiting or into the live show.
Oh, that's right. You got a whole thing then, isn't it?
Yeah.
The whole show going on in that place, isn't it? It's fucking, hey, look at that. It's you fucking loads of people in there. It's fucking.
Loads fucking, of fucking people. It's
fucking Jables fucking boogly. Why is that playing through my TV, Jables? Why are you speaking through my TV? Alexa! Make Jables speak through my speakers. Alexa, speakers for Jables, please. Now.
Did you fix it?
Well, I didn't. Alexa did. Granted, I don't own a fucking Alexa, but if you yell at them loud enough, the neighbor's Alexa does it for you.
Good tip.
How you doing, Jables?
Pretty good.
My accent scared Jeff off. He's going to fuck off to PAX early. He's going to help him set up.
How you doing?
Well, I think my glasses and my book deal say it all, don't they? Doing fucking great, man. I need a Cuban fucking chain now.
I'd buy it, but I never learned how to read.
Oh, I thought you meant you were going to buy me a Cuban neck chain. I'd wear it on the outside of my collar. That way I wasn't kidding anyone. And I'd let them know right away, yes, I am from New Hampshire. I went to college, but I didn't finish.
You'd probably have to get one of those little Italian horns, though. Look like a sperm?
The one that looks like a fucking chili pepper, right?
Yeah, or a sperm. Yeah.
I piss every Italian I see one of those off, being like, why do you wear a golden chili pepper around your neck? And I'm like, it's an Italian horn. I'm like, what does that mean?
Huh?
What does that mean anyway?
What are you guys talking about?
It's just racism stuff.
Oh.
Yeah.
You know, casual racisms towards Italians. They like to wear sperms around their necks.
What?
Lovely droplet patterns, also known as purple necklace in the original Latin.
I should never go pee. I should never go pee because I come back and I have no idea what the fuck you're talking about.
Why do you think I hold it the whole show?
Oh my god. What the fuck? So, what should we talk about? Should we talk about what the fuck is this vanity plate thing? Oh my god. Yes. Okay. No, we should let's talk about the vanity plate one. I want to get Jables' opinion on this article, okay? You ready, Jables?
Okay.
Sure. I've seen this vanity plate, by the way.
New Hampshire woman fighting to keep PB4WeGo vanity plate. A New Hampshire woman is fighting with state officials to keep the personalized license plate that's been on her vehicle for 15 years, PB4WEGO. Wendy Auger of Gonick said she received a letter from the Department of Motor Vehicles this month telling her the vanity plate, a reference to a reminder to her kids to pee before we go, is in violation of state requirements. I've been a mom for 27 years and I've been saying this for 27 years. Auger said she was shocked when the state said the plate violated a ban on vanity plates referencing an excretory function. There is a state rule in New Hampshire that your vanity plates cannot reference an excretory function.
Yeah, it's actually become a bit of a game with some people because, strangely, I think that might actually be that New Hampshire has the record, but I believe there are more vanity plates here than anywhere else.
Really?
Yeah, well, where's your classic New Hampshire libertarianism on this one?
Mm-hmm. Like, no, the libertarians.
It's just solid advice.
I can tell you having caucused with I've never caucused with, but I was the libertarian candidate for state office, and I've dealt with them a number of times. They're too busy being upset about the fact that you need a license to do someone's nails in New Jersey, so that's why they don't have a party anymore. And I'm not joking. They don't have a party anymore. The state unpartied them after the last election, saying, "Yeah, you guys don't have enough people." So, I'll be honest. New Hampshire libertarians are they take like, you know the meme about libertarians being just kind of retarded.
Yeah.
New Hampshire libertarians take that to an extreme. Like,
you know what's really weird about libertarianism and that kind of problem is libertarianism, the basic idea behind libertarianism makes sense. Totally makes sense. It's a great mitigating factor so that you make sure you don't have too much government overreach. Like, people who espouse libertarian talking points, like, I'll listen. I want to hear what you have to say because I might agree quite a bit on what you're trying to say. Probably not all of it, but I will agree. But it is rare, except for communism. I think communism is the only other, like, political ideology that has more idiots in it than libertarianism. Because, my God, there are so many moronic fucking libertarians.
I don't know, Jeff. Let's run it down here. Okay, you've got libertarians who... Yep. Well, we know all about them. They're like, and you're gonna need a license to make toast in your own kitchen!
Yeah, that's dumb.
I don't know. Have you ever met Raisu?
I love Raisu.
We do have tanky communists, and that goes without saying. But then we also have progressives, which is like, well, yes, we understand that like corporate oligarchs are taking over our government and deforesting and destroying our ecology, and also making everything more and more miserable for the middle and working classes. But what about my pronouns? Then you also have the modern conservatives. Oh, yes, we understand we don't like big government unless it comes to things such as the military, the prisons, the police, their ability to bail out the banks, their ability
Don't talk about those. Those don't exist.
Here's the thing. Ideology is intellectual poison. It turns people who would like to be intellectuals, who might actually have the wherewithal to study and learn about the shit that they need to talk about and talk about it in reasonable terms, into... foaming retards, a la Twitter. A la The Blaze, a la Young Turks, a la Hassan Piker, a la Lauren Shen, a la Sargon of a fucking God.
A la Blessed be unto all of us.
Yeah, let's not fucking kid ourselves. You give people an orthodox way of thinking, which says, hey, run with this basic idea and come up with every conceivable like offshoot of it you can, and you'll get a bunch of frothing at the mouth retards. Buy my book.
Is that in the book? Like I said earlier, I'd never learned how to read, so.
Kinda.
Aw, okay, good. My friend Adriana did not get killed by spiders. I was worried about her.
That's a brilliant... I think that's a fucking brilliant personalized vanity plate, because I've seen some pretty awful ones. There was a guy who used a clever combination of the letters 3 and a whole bunch of letters, so that when you looked at it only in the rearview mirror, his license plate said, "Eat shit."
Yeah.
That's a pretty good one. I'd go for that one. That one's pretty good.
Oh, yeah, no, the state, after they figured out what it was, they're like, wait a second, is that how ambulances work? Oh, no, you can't have that, sir.
Ambulamps.
Have yourself a whole bunch of state-made, state-sold vodka and assault rifles, but don't by chance spoil our decent white picket fence society by making a joke in someone's rearview mirror. Fucking hate this state so much.
There was also that guy in Florida that had a "I eat ass" sticker on his rear window.
Wait, that one? He got in trouble for that one? They made him take it down?
No. Well, they tried to. He took it to court, and the court decided it's part of his free speech.
Good.
Yep.
Well, I've told you guys about the 420 rallies that happened in Keene before, right?
420 rallies was Daddy Derek there?
No, this was like 2009, 2010, and it was the Libertarians, the Free Staters, and here's an example of why New Hampshire Libertarians don't know when to call a win a win. So they started doing this thing in downtown Keene, right across the street from City Hall on this roundabout, which was at the top of the main drag. They started having 420 protests every day. They'd show up at the park every day at 420, smoke a bunch of weed. Stadies, local police, they'd all see it. And then the general consensus was toleration. All right, you guys clean up after yourselves. You're not destroying anything. We know you're here and not out committing crimes. You get yourselves high, you clean up, and then you fuck off out of the park. Cool. Well, then they're like, well, we're not getting arrested to make our statement. So then they started drinking in the park, which was a violation of city and state law. But again, same attitude was taken. So they kept doing this for months and months and months. So then they decided they were going to start out with Topless Tuesdays. And so all of the activist Free State Libertarian chicks would go down and take their shirts off and have their titties hanging out. Unfortunately for them, New Hampshire is a code law state, which means that unless it's an actual violation of the letter of the law, nothing should or can be done. And New Hampshire has no law against women walking around with their titties out. There's no law against women going topless in New Hampshire.
Yeah, this just sounds like a fun time. I just go for the pre.
Well, when they found this out, they were frustrated because here's the thing. The Free State Libertarian movement here for the longest time existed, and you can find videos from them on YouTube, loads of them, where they go out of their way to get arrested so that they could stand out on Main Street under my old apartment in front of Timoleon's Diner and complain about how they were manhandled and roughhoused and their cuffs were so tight and it took 10 minutes before they got their phone call. And this is gross and authoritarian, right? Well, they found out, like, wow, okay, so they're letting us smoke weed, drink beer, and have parties in a public park in the middle of the day with titties out. What do we do next? Well, they found out, like, they started doing body painting. Finger body painting.
Finger banging?
Finger body painting. And then when somebody was painting spirals around someone's nipples, that constituted lewd and lascivious. They were arrested, and thus...
That's idiotic, dude.
The fight continued.
Jables, have you ever painted anybody's nipples?
Yeah.
Yeah?
In public?
What'd you paint on them?
I just did some stars.
Oh, that's cool. That's good. I don't think I've ever actually painted nipples. That's something that I think is not... It definitely wasn't on my bucket list, but now I think it is. Anything you want to show, promote, put out there into the world, man?
Pre-show.
Pre-show? We always whore out the pre-show. So I'm not going to get a chance to see you Friday. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I'm still trying to get rid of... You saw the box of tickets that I had.
Yeah,
I'm trying to get rid of some of those.
I saw the box, but like, are we going to be able to hang out Friday night?
Maybe Friday night after the pre-show. I'll see what's going on. Definitely Saturday, though.
Okay, cool. All right. Well, I love you, buddy. I can't wait to see you.
Yeah.
All right.
See you then.
All right. Bye.
Bye.
Bye. All right. So we need to look at this. This is actually really important.
Are you all right? You brought the tea?
No. Bring M&M.
Yeah, that's an old ass meme. I thought that was better done than it was. That makes me sad. Fucker. Oh god.
In an age of auto-tune and audio mastering, you'd think so.
Well, back better ambulamps. Call me an ambulamps. I need an ambulamps.
Bamber lamps.
That dude got fucked up, dude.
Lamb chops.
Baby lamb chops. That's fair. Lamb chops sing along. Did you ever watch Lamb Chops Sing Along when you were an adult?
I really thought you were going to ask when I was a kid. The answer to both is no.
No. So, like, there's this whole kind of renaissance thing going on where people are like, yeah, we're gonna go back. We're going to watch Mr. Rogers when we're depressed. And it just kind of, it's very comforting. Or maybe,
I'm sorry, that's not a renaissance thing. That's a grown
nostalgia,
child.
Fine, nostalgia thing. It's a nostalgia. Fine. Just stop. All right. So anyway, there's a thing where people will like watch Bob Ross, or they will watch Mr. Rogers, because it's very nostalgic, but it also is very calming. I kind of had something like that happen a really long time ago. Not to be too hipster, although I am wearing my hipster glasses. In the early 2000s, with me and my girlfriend, I actually went and downloaded a bunch of pirated copies of Lamb Chops Sing Along, and for some reason, we really like to do strange drugs and watch Lamb Chop.
Oh, okay. Well, you should have told me about the strange drugs thing. That makes it make sense.
There was definitely an infantilization aspect going on to it, though. Like, it was not... There wasn't, like, an innocent thing either, you know? This isn't just like, hey, let's watch some weird shit when we're high. This is
It's funny, because, like, I see, like, the adult coloring books that came out, right?
Oh, sure.
You know, adults in this modern age are infantilizing themselves increasingly. They're like, I'm so stressed by this world, I don't understand. I need what I had when I was a child to make me feel better.
Right.
But it's funny because at the same time, when you think about it, so if the ordinary ass plebeian adults, right, can only handle life by reverting to childhood.
Uh-huh.
The intellectuals...
Me,
an intellectual, is the one who handles the disgusting and confusing parts of the world by looking at cartoons and comic books and trying to figure out who and why is fucking who and what their genitals are and do you know about penises? Vaginas? Oh! It makes sense now.
What about you, Skull
there
Maggot?
There are no grown-ups anymore.
What about you, Skull Maggot? Do you understand penises and vaginas?
No.
Yeah, me neither. I've been. I'm 30. How old am I again?
No.
Okay, I'm 37. I'm 37 years young, and I still don't understand penises and vaginas either, man.
What's the thing? I mean, it's like people still. I mean, think about what mature adults are like now. It's like, I'm going to say awful things because I can, and you can't tell me I can't. Or,
wow.
What's She-Ra? Who does She-Ra have sex with?
Okay.
This is surprisingly relevant.
These are the adults.
Is it why?
Because I just had this sociology today.
Oh, sociology today? Right on. How'd class go?
So far, I'm liking them.
Yeah, that's good.
Public speaking is actually helping me a lot.
Dude, it will. Okay, here's the thing. I've said this before on quite a few times that I am actually kind of an introvert, and I had to train myself to be able to do this because I do now, but I didn't like public speaking. I was really, really shy. I was really nervous about the idea of like trying to perform for other people. But one of the things that really did help me was public speaking class in college. So you're starting to dig it?
Oh yeah, we had like two activities today, and it was, we couldn't speak to each other. We only had to do movement.
Oh.
And then we had to go up and tell the class about the other person we were talking to.
Okay.
It was partners.
Right. So, I mean, like, was this kind of like a Pictionary sort of thing, or like, was there very much a defined topic that you guys were trying to communicate?
It was like more a defined topic.
Okay, cool. You feel yourself, because I mean, the thing is too. At least this is my experience. Maybe it might be different for you. Maybe it's different for other people. But when I was getting into trying to curb how terrified I was, because I was really scared of that kind of shit, it was not necessarily that I became more confident, but it was more like the part of me that got really spooked and freaked out by it eventually just kind of faded into the background noise. Like, it just didn't even matter anymore. Is that how it felt with you?
Well, I get this weird feeling where I'm anxious, where I want to move. I want to say something that's in my head, but I say something completely different.
Oh, yeah. Is it like that very last minute course correction thing where you're like, I'm going to say this one thing, I'm going to say this, well, I'm going to say something else.
Yes, very.
Is it always the wrong thing? Because that's what always happened to me. Yeah, dude, I swear to God, you got to trust your instincts. You got to take the brakes off, man.
You see, I almost want to replace public speaking courses with sales courses.
Okay, how so? Because, explain.
All right, well, I mean, like I say, I've said it before, I was a virgin until I was 19, and that only got fixed thanks to a hooker in Georgia. And the thing was, it's like for the
what was her name? Shout out to you, Urethra.
Yeah, might as well have been. Fuck, I don't even remember her name. I don't even think I got her name actually.
I'm sorry.
All the same, even afterwards, right? It, like, I mean, I was always this shy, awkward, didn't know how to talk to people, didn't know how to stop giving a fuck kind of person. And then of all places, I got a job at Radio Shack because it was the only job I could find. And as soon as they told me, like, yeah, you're going to be on the sales floor, I'm like, okay, what does that entail? And they're like, you're going to be talking with and engaging with customers and upselling them and convincing them to buy things. And basically I figured out, like, okay, I need to not only be comfortable talking to people, I need to be comfortable getting people to do what I want for the reasons that I want them to do it. Which is money. And surprise, surprise, I shit you not, I went from this, like, you know, scared, like, should it still been a virgin were it not for an army platoon buying me a slightly overweight hooker who was dropped off by a cabbie with four teeth to a guy who could talk his way into and out of anything. And that was all thanks to sales, because you become a bit of what Shane Dawson might call a sociopath. Oh my God. So, but yeah, wait. No, I mean, when you learn to start talking to people, because it's fun too. The fun thing with sales, for instance, is that, like, you can't sell someone on absolute dog shit that you know they're going to try and return, because you'll lose your commission. Mm-hmm. You need to sell them on the dog shit that they don't need, and fully, thoroughly convince them that that shit is not only what they need, but what they will get joy from for longer than the return policy exists.
Okay.
And once you, when you get to that point, when you sit, when you're sitting in this, like, storefront, especially, like, as I was, where, like, there weren't so many customers, but you'd sit there and you'd see someone approaching the door and you'd be like, wait, are they coming in here? Are they coming in here? I bet they're coming in for batteries. I bet I can sell them a brand new slider phone.
Probably.
And then you do. Oh my God. You walk out, you're like, I made $60 on an elderly person who doesn't know any better. I am a god. And that's how Radio Shack works.
Larry said he's turning 40 in 3 weeks. Let's go to Vegas, dude. I mean, do you have anything important going on in 3 weeks? What are you going to do for your birthday? Just sit around and watch us being ridiculous? Let's go to Vegas.
Chrysler, what are you going to do? You're just going to sit around like, you're just going to watch our show? Why would you do that?
Vegas.
Yes. Vegas.
Skull, have you been to Vegas yet?
No, I'm only 19, almost 20.
I mean, you can still technically
birthday's in October.
You could still technically get into quite a bit of trouble in Vegas, even at 19. But, okay, I will say, don't make the mistake that I made when I turned 20. When I turned 21, I let somebody else plan my birthday, and it was an awful time. Plan your own birthday. Plan for it, save it up, make sure it's going to be fucking great. Make sure that regardless of everybody else, if everybody else in the world fucked off and did nothing, that you've got your plan solid, because you only get it once, man. And I'm gonna live vicariously through your experience when you turn 21, because mine sucked. Mine was awful. I'm not bitter. I'm just kind of fucked.
I'm hoping to go to the biggest rock concert I could possibly go to. That'd be cool. And just get drunk.
Oh wow. Wow.
Ronnie James Dio in hologram.
Had a nice bar.
You did have a nice party.
Hi, Mams.
I don't know if, like, I'll have to fuck with the fucking... there we go. That's how old were you in this?
16.
16-year-old memory right there, ladies and germs.
Wow.
Stripey shirt.
Yeah.
Am I wrong for hearing the first album from Orgy playing?
She's looking at old pictures of me.
Good, I hope she sticks around.
I can't. She has to go.
Too bad.
Exactly. I'm just. How does it feel to treat me like you do?
Oh, you can't leave.
Who's Ginger?
You have to stay. Mm-hmm. Yes, you do.
Can't.
You have to stay.
Boo.
Boo. Boo. Boo. At least give me a little shit. That'll tie me over for later. All right. I love you.
Love you too.
You're amazing. Anyway, what were we talking about?
You know, I could do the same thing, Jeff. All it would take was me offering, like... Well, I mean, it would be the same thing, but I could just, like, shake a few Hungry Man meals out down the street there, and I could have women in my apartment, too.
I know.
But...
I'm just saying, you know, like, sure, Manchester and Eugene are different cities. I'm just saying you're not the only one who can have guests in his house.
But I do want to point out something.
Yes, please. It's been awkward. You need to do this.
I feel like I am doing a little... I feel like I'm doing a little bit better talking to you guys than the first time I came here and then the few times I talked to Nick.
Yeah, I mean, like, it's just practice, you know? You know, like, we had a... did you watch the episode where we had Goose on?
Yes.
So Goose, he was saying that he was very uncomfortable about doing live stuff. It makes him a little uncomfortable, that sort of thing. God damn it. No, come back later. But he, since then, has been going on DLive for doing video game streaming, and he's killing it, man. He is killing it. He's doing really good. It just takes practice, man. That's it.
Absolutely.
Yeah, to be comfortable, not successful.
Yeah.
I hope I can come up here and make a fool of myself and be happy with it.
Oh, Skull, let me be honest with you. As an actor, as a guy who's done this enough times, et cetera, et cetera, you will never be more foolish in life than you will be if you are afraid of being a fool.
Yeah.
If you fucking put it all out there, if you lay it all out there, you can be the biggest, most embarrassing weirdo fucking jackass in the universe, right? That is still less embarrassing than not doing anything and worrying that you will look foolish.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Because nobody remembers and nobody actually gives a shit.
No, that is the secret. That's the fucking secret, man. Holy shit. Nobody remembers and nobody cares. So there's like this whole thing. So real life is way different than the internet, but even the internet, with the whole the internet never forgets. Yeah, the internet never forgets, but the internet also gets distracted and doesn't pay attention anymore. Real life, in real life, people forget and don't give a shit about that kind of crap after like a week. Nobody cares. Yeah, nobody gives a fuck.
Yeah, it's a fun and interesting lesson actually I learned while training as an actor actually. Cuz like I've never done stage work. Right? Really want to, but I've never done stage work before. I've only done screen acting. And when I was training, my friend and mentor, Chris Berry, you know, he came up on the stage himself and he asked, he's like, you ever done stage? Why don't you do stage? And I told him, well, I mean, it's fucking nerve wracking. You only get that one shot to get the performance right. You're in front of all those people who are right there live watching you. And he points out, he's like, okay, yeah, but what does that mean? Because ask yourself this, think of all the big actors you've ever heard of. How many of them have you ever heard of being panned for a bad stage performance, flubbing a line or dropping a line, versus how many of you heard panned for life for one bad movie? Robert Pattinson, great example. The kid did Twilight. Yeah. Amazing fucking actor. He will never outlive Twilight.
I disagree.
Well, I hope he does.
Because he's got a new video, new movie that came out recently at the
you hear what my point is though. It's like he did Water for Elephants. He was fucking brilliant in that.
He was brilliant. He was great.
He's a great actor in everything he's been in.
Mm-hmm.
And yet to most people, he's the guy from Twilight.
I think he's gonna beat it. I think he's gonna beat it. He just came out with an incredible movie called The Lighthouse. I was talking with Adam from Your Movie Sucks. Willem Dafoe and Robert Pattinson in this movie. Like, this movie came out in all the movie festivals, and everybody lost their shit over this movie.
Really?
Actually,
yeah. More so than anybody has, like, than in any film in, like, a good 15 years. People lost their fucking mind.
Yeah, Skull Maggot, actually, though, you know what? That, let me just, I mean, I don't know where you are, but if you can find yourself even just a community level theater, or especially if you can find a film acting class, if you can find a film acting class or you know, workshop of any kind that you can get a part of, you don't even need to perform on stage or on screen. Just audit the class and give it a try. Because one of the, like, every acting class I've ever gone to, one of the big things we've always done is warm-ups. And the warm-up is usually some bizarro fucking improv game where you stand, basically the whole point is to stand in front of the rest of your class and just be as fucking weird as you can, right?
Just pull your dick out and start swinging around in circles.
And it's funny though, it's funny because the lesson you learn from that, right? Like auditioning for films, I've gone to auditions in Midtown Manhattan, I've gone to auditions in downtown New Orleans. And one of the things I picked up and started doing in order to loosen up for the auditions was when I'd take the bus or the streetcar or however I was getting there, both while I was walking down the street as well as while I was on these public transports, I would think of a song that I knew and I liked, and I would just start singing it out loud. And I would start singing it to, if I caught someone looking at me, I would just look them in the eye and start singing to them and then keep singing and move on. And I would do this even while I was walking to the audition office, just for the specific fact that when I got in the room, I would know that I had already done the most embarrassing, ridiculous shit I would do all day. Nothing I could do in there would be remotely as embarrassing as that. Learn to fucking throw yourself out there, because people don't give a shit. And when you learn that and you get comfortable with it, the lengths to which you can take it get hilarious and obnoxious and so much fun.
Hey, Skull. What would you like to shill, promote, put out there into the world, man?
Hello?
Oh, shit. He's not in the room. What the fuck? Hello? Hi.
I'm back.
Yeah. I think you missed most of Nick's thing, maybe. I don't know. Anything you want to shill, promote, put out there into the world, my dude?
Probably Scares to Care again.
Which one?
Scares to Care.
Scares to Care. Okay.
That Care.
Scares to Care. Did you send me the link last time on that one?
I think you just looked it up on Facebook last time.
Yeah, that might be right. Also, by the way, thank you so much for sending me that urine injection video that I used at the roundout.
Oh, you're absolutely welcome.
You fucking deadly ass legend. Oh my god, thank you. I didn't know how that was gonna go over, but holy shit, people loved that.
I gotta say, probably, I had a bad day of college yesterday. I was upset because some of the work wasn't operating correctly on my computer. And I watched you on the live show that night, and seeing that made me feel so much better.
Yeah, yeah. No, I feel it. I feel it, man. And, you know, I haven't really talked about it too much, but I had, like, a really horrible week. A really, really horrible week. I've actually had a really horrible month, to be honest. Everything's been really, like, up in the air and kind of terrible. But doing the roundup yesterday was really great. Today, I've done over 11 hours worth of editing, and I'm probably going to edit even more once I'm done with the show tonight. Because the Olive/Hemlock Moonwolf thing needs to come out tomorrow, which it will be. But no.
Oh,
like,
boy.
Oh, yeah, no, it's gonna, dude, listen. This video is gonna be sick as fuck. Sick as fuck. I'm super excited about it. She's great.
Hey, Hemlock Moonwolf was like one of my favorite things to watch.
I have so many more ideas now for Hemlock Moonwolf. They all happened within the past 2 weeks. Holy shit. So I think with the kid going back into school in exactly 1 week, I'll have a lot more time to be able to do more principal photography, and I can put out more Hemlock Moonwolf videos. Yeah, dude, I'm super into it. And again, I wanted to thank you because Skull, for those who don't know, if you didn't watch the roundup, Skull Maggot is the guy who sent me the urine injection video of the Indian gentleman who literally injects piss into his muscular system. The sacred Shavambu. First, we must wash the needle with the Shivambu. Then we must sterilize our thigh by rubbing some Shivambu on the injection site. Then we inject the Shivambu.
But before I get off,
yeah,
the rabbit hole I went into to get to that video was so bad.
Yeah?
I came across Amanda Mary again. I came across some other guy explaining to put pee up their bum.
Yes, oh yes, oh yes, yes, yes. Well, look, all I know is that was the second most impactful moment of the roundup, and I'll tip my own hat. I accurately predicted that that would be a great video to put right in the goddamn middle, because you found me something that was so potent. So thank you. You helped make this roundup very, very special, and I am very thankful. Thank you, buddy.
You're very welcome, and thank you.
Yeah, for sure, man. Do me a favor, your recommendation, if you have the web link, if you can, just DM that to me on Discord, and otherwise I'll talk to you next time, all right?
Okay. Take care.
Oh, sweet. Later, buddy. I almost moved Nick instead of Skull. There we go. All right, bye. All right. Sweet. I don't know what happened to Nick. I think Nick might be pooping. So what we're going to do is this.
Also, he died from the blood clot explosion that caused one of his testicles to explode, and he got a lot of blood loss. But Jesus said that he was having a blast with Hugh Hefner in heaven. And I said, really? I said, why did Hugh get to heaven? Is it because he had a good heart? And said, yeah, he pretty much had loving motives, so that's why he got to heaven. So
Hugh Hefner had loving motives, of course.
Of course, once he was writing his will, and he was going to give me and Brent the Playboy Mansion, and
right.
Lori prevented that from happening by murdering him before the will became official. So that's the reason he was murdered. You got to understand something about Jesus. I'm going to make a statement which may shock a lot of theologians out there and evangelical Christians.
Yeah, get your pearls ready to be clutched, ladies and gentlemen.
And those who think I'm crazy and there's no way I could be meeting with the real Jesus because why isn't he stopping me from posing nude and making a fool out of myself? You have to understand something about Jesus. In Genesis 1, in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve were naked and not ashamed.
Mm-hmm.
So when the world is not filled with sin, nakedness is cool. There's also a naked prophet in the Bible, Isaiah. Did you know that God ordered Isaiah for 3 years to preach naked to the nation of Israel? He said, I want you to take all your clothes off. I mean, just stark naked, just like the way he came out of his mother's, when he was born. And he said, I want you to preach to them and tell them that if they don't quit their idolatry and if they don't quit their sin, that they're going to go into captivity, and their captors will make them all go into captivity with stark naked with no clothes on. So for 3 years, Isaiah preached stark naked. And God.
So, Barr's asking, I have no idea if she's lying or not. No. Listen, I'm gonna be dead fucking serious with you right now. Gail Cord Schuller is not a troll. This woman is not a troll. This woman really, truly, utterly believes every single fucking word that comes out of her mouth. Every single one. I have spent, I don't know how many fucking hours watching her videos, talking to the people in her life, and even talking to her. Look at her fucking eyes, dude. She's not a troll. She's crazy. Or enlightened. I don't know which. I don't know. But it's enough that I love her and I will always be a patron of her. I love Gail Cord Schuller. She is my quang. She's my quang. I love her so much. Oh my god. Larry Kubiak says, you know, I really wanted to wait until Nick got back to play this. But I don't know what's happening to Nick, so I'm just going to have to play it otherwise. I'm sorry, Larry. If you need me to, I'll play it when Nick gets back. Larry says, you know, you're becoming a boomer when people send you this shit with laugh my ass off XD comment. Join me in my suffering. All right.
He was smoking.
Somebody sent you this? Dev Crew?
Hey.
Oh, hey. What's up? What's up, Big Money?
My dad was smoking.
Oh, he's smoking? You know what? You're taking over for your dad. Can you hear this video when I play it? Hang on.
Yes, I can.
You can? All right. You know what? You're my new co-host. Fuck your dad. Your dad sucks. You're Not if he starts coming back in, you tell him to get the fuck out. You are my new co-host.
Like, seriously, like, do the F word?
No, I'm sorry. No, I should not undermine the parenting. Don't
get
say
out!
That's right. Don't say the F word. Don't say the F word. If you feel like you want to say the F word, you gotta say Frogger.
I am a very
get the flop out.
Whoa.
Get the flop out.
Get the flop
door.
Oh.
Headlock.
Stop it! Headlock. You smell like cigarettes.
All right.
Up. Say goodnight.
Night. Night, no. Quinn.
Hey, you know what? You know what, Quinn? Quinn.
What? What?
We're gonna do a private show later. We're gonna review Roblox memes. All right.
All right.
God no! What are you thinking? Okay. I've seen those things. Go.
All right, bye.
The cubicles representing for my Java homies.
In by 9, out when the deadlines are met.
Check it. We code hard in these cubicles. Styles nerd chic, I'm a programming freak. We code hard in these cubicles. Only 2 hours till your deadline, don't sweat my technique. Sipping morning coffee with that Java swirl. Born to code, my first words were hello world. Since 9 to 5, been Java coding, staying proud. Started on floppy disk, now we take it to the cloud. On my desktop, Java's what's bobbing and weaving. I got another winning app before I get to odd even. Blazing code like a forest fire, climbing a tree. Setting standards like IEEE. Boot it on up, I use the force like Luke. Got so much love from my homeboy Duke. GNU public license, it's open source. Stop by my desk when you need a crash course. Written once and my script runs anywhere. Yeah. Straight thugging, mean mugging in my Aeron chair. Oh. All the best lines of code, you know I wrote them. I'll run you out of town on your dial-up modem.
Do we have a comment on this? Okay.
You know, it's sort of like a hymnal.
Cause we code hard in these cubicles. Me and my crew code hyphy hardcore. We code hard in these cubicles. It's been more than 10 years since I've seen it for a board. Inheriting a project can make me go berserk. Ain't got 4 hours to transfer their framework. The cleaners killed the lights. Man, that ain't nice. Gonna knock this program out like Kimbo Slice. I program all night, just like a champ. Look alive under this IKEA lamp. I code harder in the midnight hour east.
Kimbo Slice was overrated. That's for you, Bar. I know you know who I'm talking about. I'm really not...
I mean,
not...
It's well produced.
Yeah, no, yeah. Kimbo Slice is way overrated. Holy shit. Fucking A, dude. That's why he's dead. He's dead. Actually, he didn't die because he was overrated. He died because he had congenital heart problems, I think. I think that's what it was, wasn't it? Kimbo died because he had, like... Someone was fucked up with his heart. I can't remember.
It was just too big.
He was a big dude. Yeah.
Yeah, and his heart was just too big for this world.
Yeah, heart attack. Yeah, dude. Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. If you ever wanted, like, somebody to be a good fighter based on how mean they look, ain't nobody ever looked meaner than Kimbo fucking Slice. That motherfucker looked mean.
Well, yeah, but Kimbo Slice, I mean, like, the only reason, like, it was, like, he kind of came up on the dawn of, you know, viral meme kind of things, because he had that whole nasty backyard brawler thing where he just beat the shit out of everyone in his neighborhood.
Right. But then you'd have some Hispanic dude like 40 pounds lighter than him just tear him apart. Rip his fucking shit up. Over and over. He just wasn't that good of a fighter. He looked mean. Anyway.
Yeah, but I mean, is this college humor or
I don't know who the fuck this is. I don't know who. No, it just says Java.
It's like Funny or Die or some shit. And we all know somebody who had a Funny or Die rap video, don't we?
Oh, you want to talk about Fedor? Okay, we are not gonna get into an MMA/pride fighting championship show. That's not what tonight's show is about. Maybe we'll do like one show dedicated to pride fighting championships. That would be great. I'd be down for that.
You know, I think we need to reform the whole thing so that pride fights are between the toughest trans folk at the parade.
That's not funny. That's awful. Oh my god, I'm not gonna get canceled because I laughed at that joke, because I was just laughing so that they wouldn't target me.
It's also pride, you know, it's also profitable, so copyright pride fights, y'all.
Right. Machine fuels my power. PS3 to smartphones, our code use never ends. Java's there when I beat you in words with friends. My developing skills are so fresh. Please discuss, you better step your game up on that C++. We know better than to use .net. Even Dan Brown can't code as hard as me. You know Java's getting bigger, that's a promise, not a threat. Let me code it on your brain so you never forget. A little rapey, don't you think? That's kind of rapey.
I just gotta say, I mean, like, this is like vintage epic rap battles before they were like, hey, let's just get failed SNL comics to come on and join us.
I guess. Code hard in these cubicles. It's the core component of what we implement. We code hard in these cubicles. Straight to your Java runtime environment. We code hard in these cubicles. Keep the syntax light and the algorithm tight. I don't have anything to add.
I mean,
I just don't want to. I just don't want to give these fucking people money. That's it. We code hard in these cubicles. Gotta use Java if it's gonna run right. We code hard in these cubicles. Java keeps adapting. You know it's built to last. We code hard in these cubicles. Robust and secure, so our swag's on blast. You know what? Maybe what we should do is at one point, maybe we should do, like, a Saints special, and we'll stream it to PlexStorm, even though we don't really need to stream it to PlexStorm, but we'll just do it to PlexStorm just because it'd be funny. And we'll have, like, the most violent shit we can find for, like, Pride Fighting Championships, and we'll just do, like, a show where we review it. I think that'd be great.
I was trying to come up with a revised verse for this terrible rap about how his midlife crisis will be well earned.
We'll do like, what was his name?
What was I his sold name? All of my youth to them so I could sit in a basement and code this dumb shit.
Bar, help me out. What was the name of the guy? He did a bunch of Pride Fighting Championship. He went and he fought Takayama. He had already beat Kent Shamrock. And he fights Takayama, and they just like, bam, bam, bam. They're just like punching each other in the same face, or in each other's face at the same time. Come on, you gotta know who I'm talking about. What's that dude's name?
Was Bar?
No, it wasn't. It was not Dan Severin. No, it was not. No, it was not. Mm-mm. I'm gonna find it. But meanwhile, Yami. Hi, Yami.
Hi.
How you doing?
I'm doing good. Jackie's sleeping. She had a long day.
Jackie.
I don't know why. I know. All this week she's been having bad days at work, and it makes me feel bad. I was like, oh. So I've been trying to cheer her up as much as I can, but...
The Ides of August.
I don't know. Maybe. I think it's just more work drama and shit like that, so it's like, can I just go in there and punch everyone?
That's fair. Yeah. Don Fry. It was Don Fry, Bar. That's who we were talking about. It was Don Fry. Bar doesn't even know what he's talking about.
I don't know. I mean, well, then again, I don't even know what the hell we're talking about, so I can't comment.
Okay, so here's the main thing that we were talking about. So I'm gonna put this up in a very specific link. Do you have an ability to watch on like a different tab, maybe in your browser?
I'm pretty sure. We'll
yeah.
See.
Okay. Here, we'll I'm gonna DM you real quick.
Okay. Oh, did you see my other DMs too, or no?
I see them now that I'm trying to DM you, but I haven't read them yet because my vision's a little blurry. You have to remind me tomorrow. Sorry.
That's fine. I probably will get up at, like, 8, so your time, I'll probably wait for, like, an hour or two.
Oh, that's fair. Okay, cool. So you have the MyCircle open. So what we're talking about, because I keep getting into these conversations with a bunch of people who are very much like, I am a man who understands MMA fighting. I love Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. And me, I'm a guy who likes old school pride fighting. And most people, I have found, don't know what pride fighting is. Are you a fan of fights of, like, boxing or MMA?
I've seen MMA. They get pretty intense, but I wouldn't mind watching it. I just never actually sat down and watched an entire thing.
Well,
although
you,
I do
you,
like...
you were in the military, so you were taught hand-to-hand combat.
A little bit. I was only in it for about 1 year, 3 months, and 14 days.
Well, that's
so...
fair. That's fair.
I'm more comfortable with my 9mm than I am hand-to-hand.
Sure,
so.
Sure. No, I'm with you on that one. So do you have that My Circle open?
I do, and it's the Java Life map or wrap thing that's still up.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. All right, here we go.
Don Fry is back. The man that...
So we're gonna skip through this just a little bit because this is just nothing impressive, but... Look at the physique of Don Fry. Look at this fucking guy. He's a monster.
Actually, he kind of reminds me of this old 1980s WWF wrestler. But
Which
I can't
one?
Remember his name. I can't remember his name.
The Iron Sheik.
Oh, okay. So he's going up against Yoshihiro Takayama. Takayama was a fucking beast. An absolute fucking beast. And they square off, they get very, very, very serious. And then this shit gets so absolutely out of fucking control. Here we go. And watch this shit. This is insane.
Oh, nice. He just goes
just, and then that starts happening.
That is amazing. And none of them are even backing down.
No, neither of them back down. Neither of them back down. They literally both beat each other in the fucking face until they literally cannot anymore. They literally beat each other into fucking hamburger.
Keep going.
Amazing. Oh, right on an uppercut, too. That's nice.
Like I said, he's not going to back down.
And then this clip is like, it skips forward a little bit. Obviously, it doesn't show like the whole fight or whatnot. But it ultimately comes down to Takayama has to be called out because he basically, this is what happens. Watch this shit. This is crazy. Don Fry just keeps fucking clocking him. And Takayama can barely lift his head.
He's only got one. But it's a Chevy Chevelle.
Now,
Don
Fry,
I appreciate that. I've never the beginning.
They had to call it because Takayama could barely stand, but he's such a fucking... He's an incredible fighter. Incredible fighter. But he's such a beast, he won't go down. Eventually, the refs are like... We can't let these guys actually fight anymore. This has to stop. So they all the refs come together and are like, this fight is done. Let's count up the points. No more. And Don Fry wins. But him and Takayama, they share a great fucking hug at one point. Look at Takayama's face right now.
He kind of looks like a mixture of Jackie Chan and Rambo if they got into a really bad fight.
He looks like mashed potatoes.
He's fucked up, dude. Well, you see, to me, like, you know, growing up as I did in the 80s and 90s, right?
It looks like as if part of his nose is not only broken, but I think something above his cheek, or just below his eyes, but above his cheek is broken, too.
Yeah.
I want to say either a bone or something. Like
no, his face is a bag. It's like the bottom of a bag of potato chips right now in terms of its bone structure.
Sure.
Here's the thing, though. Like, I remember, like, I ran with some fucking dirty ass kids when I was young. But I remember that's what fights used to look like. It was
smash in the face,
get smashed, keep smashing, and that was what it was. These days, and it's like I said, it was like a year or two ago, last big street fight I saw, everyone's trying to do MMA takedowns to the ground, and then one guy gets this other dude on the ground and he gives him fish hooks.
Yeah, and then you're fucked up, man. You get fucked up.
I will say this. The only thing that I can say when I go into fights is I can't, because of my height, I can't reach up. So what I'll do is I'll try to grab the arm and aim for the kidneys as hard as I can.
Oh, yeah. That's cool.
I did that. I accidentally did that to Jackie once, and she's like, please don't.
You know, I've heard lesbian relationships have the highest rates of domestic violence, and now I know why.
Actually, we were out drinking, and I think I had a little too much to drink. I was trying to impress her friend, who was a Marine. And
yeah, I was trying to impress this Marine by beating the shit out of my wife.
You know, it's fine.
The story is old as time, Yami. As old as time.
When a Navy and a Marine are together, you know we have to show up each other. We either have to one-up each other.
Listen, I was going
to
say...
the Army gets in, and we all have to one-up each other.
I was going to say that, like, you know, when the Navy, when a Navy person and a Marine person get together, at least you can generally assume it's hetero. But apparently I'm wrong.
Oh, you are so wrong.
Well, I mean, it's not... Well, listen, I mean, you know, as a Navy lady, I, you know, like, you don't want to be the barrel boy.
No one wants to be the barrel boy.
But someone ends up doing it anyway.
Oh, this is why we don't say never again volunteer yourself, because they don't tell you you're going to be the barrel boy.
Takeyama was such a good fucking sport about that fight, too. Like, he took the dude can barely fucking stand, he can barely see. But he took the time to stand up and to share the mustache with the world.
And he was just, well, I love that pose too. He's like, this motherfucker here, real deal.
It looks like as if they were holding each other's heads at the end and just trying to keep the other standing up.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And they were just like weakly punching each other as if they were just like, eh.
Well, at this point, they're Eiffel Towering so they can just make sure that neither one of them falls down.
Right. Now, that's really good sportsmanship, I think. When you're actually trying to keep your opponent up, so that way you both can at least look somewhat dignified of the fight.
The truth is here's a really uncomfortable truth that a lot of people are not comfortable with when it comes to fighting. And this is the truth. Anything that resembles a sport is not a good reflection of what it's like when you actually have to fight on the street. Not at all.
Oh, no. No.
Not even close. Not even remotely. Holy shit. Mm-mm. And then the things that you have, like, for sport that you will have out there will always have rules and restrictions that will make it so other types of specific martial arts are going to be kneecapped. For instance, like, Muay Thai. A good third of Muay Thai you can't fucking use in MMA. You can't fucking use a good third of it. The entire, like... One third of the entire martial practice of Muay fucking Thai is designed to disable or fucking kill. And you can't use any of that in fucking MMA.
Actually,
people be like, well, that's because Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is just superior to fucking Muay Thai. No, it ain't.
It's not.
It's because the rules tell you that you can't use the Muay Thai.
Here's an interesting point I actually just thought of, though. When it comes
Bar's gonna get mad because Bar's a fucking Brazilian jiu-jitsu dude. He's gonna get super ass mad about it too. It's gonna be great.
Well, think about this though. Even when it comes to like classic dueling, right? Or even just fighting.
Sure.
Like Jesus fucking Christ.
Oh no, I heard
all the same.
Yeah, in the background.
Yeah, well, think about what is the nature of having a second, right? In duels, in fights, whatever, you'd always have your boy standing on the back, and neither one of the seconds were supposed to get involved, right?
Sure.
Right.
Except for if things went wonky.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah. My one genuine bar fight, which I lost, because I'm woefully out of shape and woefully out of practice, and also he had like fucking 3 inches on me and was able to get me on the ground. But yeah, I mean, at the end of the thing, like I gave him like 3 good shots with a roundhouse kick to the same spot in the fucking rib cage because he just kept his fucking hands up. But all the same, when all that went down and was all over, it ended because we ended up in a grappling match on the ground. Dude was straddling me over me. I had both of his wrists locked up with my hands. Neither of us could move. Neither of us could do anything. After a while, I'm just like, this is fucking stupid. Get off me. He's like, you give up? I'm like, yeah, I give up. Get the fuck off me. We're done. You win, whatever. And as he's getting up, he fucking rocks me in the fucking head and cracks my head back, and it bounces off the pavement, and I hear ringing in my head. But my backup, my buddy, was a 3-time Iraq Marine vet, big fucking honking dude with a very strong sense of honor. Didn't get involved in anything until after dude had agreed the fight was over and then cheap shotted me to the face and bounced my head off the pavement, at which point he picks this scrawny little fuck up by his neck and smashes him against a brick wall several times and turns his face into hamburger and then puts his boot into the guy's sternum, causing him to fucking fountain blood out of his fucking mouth.
Oh, yeah. Oh, wow. Oh, good stuff. Good stuff.
Well, afterwards, like, we went and drank more, my friend and I, and he was so fucking angry simply because dude had violated what he thought was the code of ethics when it comes to a bar fight. And I'm like, I don't want to get you angry again. Cool. Yeah, he was a fucking douchebag. Bad boy.
I get it.
Meanwhile, like, I'm like bleeding out of my fucking mouth and shit. And I'm like, yeah, all right. That's the second. That's why they're there.
So, yeah, I mean, anything you want to show, promote, put out there into the world?
Other than my Twitter, or not Twitter. no one doesn't want to see my Twitter. Other than my Twitch channel, I guess we can promote Olive's channel, too.
Yes, no, we'll promote all, like, I will be promoting Olive's channel a lot tomorrow. I promise. It'll be great. Okay, well, we love you, Yami. You are fantastic. And as was predicted, it bothers me to no end that you were also in the military.
Why?
I have a thing about military women.
I'm sure you don't. Anyways, love right. You guys.
Love you too. Bye-bye, Yami. Okay, so Larry Kubiak says, an oldie but a goodie. Boss Rootin is my spirit animal. Fuck yes, dude. Oh my god. I will fucking stand so hard for fucking Boss Rootin. Boss is the shit, dude. Okay, hang on. Have you ever seen Boss Rootin?
Not off the top of my head, no.
Oh my god, you're in for a fucking treat, dude.
Let me tell you first that I've been around. I've been a bouncer for many, many years. Bang, bang, bang. It's a street fight. Never look away from your opponent. Look, sir, I really don't want anything of this. And I go whoop, like this, and I slit your throat, and it's over and out. Everybody underestimates the kick in the groin. Boom! That's the first thing to do. I follow up. Bang, bang, bang. Right away after that, dang it, dang it, dang. See what I'm doing?
Jeff?
Boom! That's the left elbow right there.
Barroom Titus Polo.
Yeah, yeah. Honestly, Boss Rootin is fucking Titus Polo. Straight the fuck up. Have you ever seen... Oh, God, I'm going to have to find some of his fights. If I don't know if this clip has any of his fights... But I'm going to find some of the Boss Rootin KO compilations just in case this doesn't have a minute.
I can also deliver. Bang! Headbutt out of nothing. Boom! The right elbow. Bring right straight. Maybe now the headbutt comes. Knee to the face. And looky, look what we got here. Smack his face. Smack his face.
Oh.
Create distance and grab a chair. He can slam it into his face. He can stab with it. And while I throw it at him, I will kick him in the groin, boom, right straight. Gonna bounce his head on the table.
Larry, are you gonna be cool, Larry, if I just switch over to him doing knockouts? Let me know. I'm gonna play this until you let me know.
My whole point about this is to hurt him as much as possible in any conceivable way that I can. I just look for that way to do it, and I will do it.
This dude is a fucking monster, dude.
Don't you ever do this. Right away you say, okay, I'm sorry. Bang, bang, bang. No, I'm not. And he comes in, boom, front kick. Boom, boom. Simultaneously, the elbow in the head, grab his wrist, grab your own wrist, and bend his arm. I control him, you see? Knee in the head. I can bounce him against the wall. Everything I want to do. We grab, but just to make sure, we grab this arm also. Now we're in total control. She tried to kill me, so I gotta return it the favor. I step underneath here, and now I'm controlling him with my head, and I can stab his own knife here in the liver. Watch. I'm grabbing the inside of his hand like this. One, two. Support his elbow. I can, of course, kick him in the head. I really want to be. I can put my knee on and break the arm. Never, ever let him take that choke. Because if you're out, God knows what they're going to do.
Boz is so fucking brutal, dude. This guy is absolute fucking maniac.
One, kick to the knees. Or maybe a heel. Heel to the balls. Heel to the balls. And I
can heel to the balls.
I go back with a headbutt.
All right, if you don't mind, Larry, we're gonna watch some of his knockouts. This is some real shit right here. This is some real shit. You ever watch a guy knock somebody out by just kicking him in the fucking stomach? You ever see a guy literally shut another human being down by just kicking him straight in the fucking chest? Fight's over. He's a fucking maniac, dude. He's so fucking crazy. Baz is an absolute animal. He's an animal, dude. MMA didn't have any gloves or anything. A lot of these are pride fights. A lot of these are not like sanctioned octagon, basic MMA kind of stuff. Like this is some. A lot of this is Japanese fights. I'm trying not to get copyright claimed by the music, but. This is the most insane thing in the world. Watch this shit. And that was the end of the fight too. That was the end of the fight. The fight started off with Baz smacking the dude right in his fucking teeth with his shin. And then halfway through the fight, you think it's going to be halfway through the fight, he puts him in a submission hold and the dude just gives up. It's crazy. I'm just saying, man. This is before MMA UFC came in with all their stupid rules and made it super lame. I didn't do it. Don't get mad at me. Well, I think that's it, actually. Damn. I think we're done. Nick isn't even here. Quinn! Quinn! I need you as a co-host. Come here, Quinn. Quinn! Paging Mrs. Quinn. You need to come and help me end the show. No? Well, fuck.
Hello.
We have to end the show. If you don't end the show, I'm gonna have to use your daughter and to be my co-host to say goodnight.
Well, you can't do that.
Okay. Well, then you and I have to end the show.
Well, you've all sat through this, and you've sat through it 100 times before. Tell your grandfathers, lo siento, pero gracias.
Was that supposed to be like the point where we end the show?
Oh, you didn't see the promo, did you?
No. Did you make a promo this? Did you make a promo today?
Yeah.
Oh. Wow. That would have been a really great outro. That would have been perfectly timed, actually.
Well, happy Abuelos Day to our Mexican kin. It's National Grandfather's Day. It's actually National Grandparents Day throughout the Latin world right now. But you wouldn't know that because you're a racist from Portland.
I am actually pretty racist. I love you guys. Fantastic. See you next time. Love you. Basrutin is my fucking beast mode animal.
Boy.
Fuck yeah. Fuck you, MMA Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Kiss my ass. Bye-bye, everybody. Bye-bye.
Gracias, abuelo. I learned about twice as much Spanish as I've ever known today.
That's good. Fantastic. Bar's like, I'm gonna choke you, Jeff. But he's gonna be just staying on his fucking island, banging a bunch of home-wrecking ass women, trying to find some adventure away from their tax attorney husbands over in Virginia.
Yeah, but while he's choking them, he's gonna be thinking about you. You know, that's something he's gonna have to use.
Everybody thinks about me.
When they're choking somebody.
When they're choking somebody. Are they masturbating in the night?
That homeless guy was really confused when I was calling him Jeff yesterday just before I watched his light go out.
My name is Mark! Oh, you're dead. Good.
It was Mark, but it'll always be Jeff to me.
Yes, right. That's right. You know what? Nothing gets me off more than people naming their murder victims after me. Wow.
At least they're not naming their children after their own murder victims.
Well, I'm not participating in this any further.
Hey,
nope.
Listen, I'm thinking I'm on the same wavelength, dude. I can't believe we've actually done this show 100 times and, like, you know, we just talk about these things without acting on them. It's amazing to me, too. But, you know, we talked about that at Kilroy, so we don't have to talk about it again, like we agreed.
It's the same thing I did with my family.